Hello everybody, this is Serpent, and in this video I'll be showing you how to find the Jacobian determinant and Jacobian matrix of a coordinate system, and then to use the determinant in a triple integral. For this video, my example coordinate system will be cylindrical, so the work will be done in relation to the cylindrical coordinate system. So the basic steps we're going to be following are, first we need to find the transformations from one coordinate system to Cartesian, in this case from cylindrical to Cartesian, and then moving on from that we need to find the partial derivatives in respect to the two coordinate systems, and then we can use that to find the Jacobians, the Jacobian matrix, and the Jacobian determinant, and then from there we can integrate. So the transformations from cylindrical to Cartesian are as follows. They're pretty simple, of course. You can look these up for a given coordinate system, or you can try and figure them out yourself if that's something you're interested in. So z is going to equal z, and y and x are going to equal the same things that they equal in polar coordinates. So that's going to be r cosine theta and r sine theta, respectively. So from here, we can find the partial derivatives with respect to the two coordinate systems. So we want to find x with respect to r, x with respect to theta, y with respect to r, y with respect to theta. So first let's do dx dr, and then dx d theta, and etc. So if we're doing, if we're finding the derivative of x with respect to r, then theta is going to be a constant. So that means cos theta will be constant, which means that we have the equivalent of some constant times r. So that's going to be cos theta, which is the constant times the derivative of r, which is just 1. So dx d theta now means that r is going to be held constant, and we need to find the derivative with respect to theta. So if r is constant, then we've got just r times the derivative of cos theta, which is minus sine theta. So we've got minus r sine theta. Next, we're going to do y with respect to r. So dy dr equals sine theta for the same reason dx dr is cos theta. And dy d theta is going to equal r cos theta for the same reason that dx d theta is minus r sine theta. Cos theta is the derivative of sine theta. I'm mostly going to ignore z in this situation because z equals z. So z is not affected by r or theta, and dz dz is equal to 1. So I'm mostly going to ignore that. So dz d theta is 0, dz dr is 0, similarly, dx dz is 0 and dy dz is 0. So we can move on to the Jacobian matrix now. So it's going to be a 3x3 matrix, and with cylindrical you can sort of ignore an extra dimension because z doesn't do a whole lot, but I'll show you why by not ignoring it. This is going to be the matrix of partial derivatives. So we're going to have dx dr, dx d theta, dx dz, and of course all the other ones too. I just paused for a second to make the matrix bigger. It was unreadable. So we've got drs in this column, and we've got d theta in this column, and dz in this column, and we've got dx in this row, dy dz in this row. This is the Jacobian matrix for cylindrical coordinates, and to find the Jacobian determinant we take the determinant of this matrix, and this matrix represents the all the changes of Cartesian space with respect to cylindrical space, and if we take the determinant then we'll get the volume scaling factor that we can use to find the volume of cylindrical space. So thanks to our work up here we know already that dx dr is cos theta, dx d theta is minus r sine theta, and dx dz is 0. We know that dy dr is sine theta. We know that dy d theta is r cos theta. That's another 0. Dy dz is 0. We know that dz dr is 0, dz d theta is 0, and dz dz is 1. And this is why we can ignore the 3x3 matrix and focus on the 2x2 matrix in cylindrical coordinates, because we have zeros over here, zeros over here, and a 1 here. And we will be going along this column to find the determinant, or sorry, this row. And you can see that multiplying by 0 and 0 isn't going to change our value much, and multiplying by 1 means that we just take the determinant of this 2x2 matrix there. So that would be the matrix you would use if you didn't want to demonstrate that you would not get a different value by using the 3x3 matrix. So we've got 1 times the determinant of that 2x2 matrix, which is equal to cos theta times r cos theta minus r sine theta times sine theta. And that's equal to r cos squared theta plus r sine squared theta, which is equal to r times cos squared theta plus sine squared theta. And cos squared theta plus sine squared theta is equal to 1. So this is equal to r. So r is our Jacobian determinant. And that's the volume scaling factor for our integral. So now, if we wanted to find the volume of a cylinder with, say, radius a and height b, then we could do this with a triple integral of our Jacobian determinant. So if we take the integral from 0 to b in z, of 0 to a in r, of 0 to 2 pi in theta, from 0 to 2 pi in theta means that we go around once, since 2 pi is a one full circle. We take that integral of r d theta dr dh. If we then start to evaluate this from the inside out, that leaves us with r times 2 pi dr dh. And the next step out, since we're integrating with respect to r, gets us a squared over 2. And I already pulled the 2 pi out. dh, and the 2's cancel out, which leaves us with pi times b times a squared. As stated over here, a is our radius, so this is equal to pi r squared times b, which is actually our height. So the formula we've gotten out of integrating here is pi r squared h, which is indeed the formula for the volume of a cylinder. Now, back when we found the Jacobian determinant, that might seem a little arbitrary, but I can actually show you that it makes sense that we get that value. So as you're integrating in terms of h, you're adding up circles, and the circles are formed from pizza slices, where this angle is d theta, and the pizza slices are formed from little ring segments like that, where the width of the ring segment here is equal to dr. So you're adding up little bits of area in this shape here. And to find the Jacobian determinant, we can find the area of that shape. So to find the area of that shape, we first need the area of the circle, which I'll get to in just a second, but that's pi r squared, where this value here is r. And we can use the area of the circle to find the area of the pizza slice. So the area of the pizza slice is the area of the circle times the ratio of the arc length here to the circumference of the circle. And the arc length can be found from s equals r theta, where in this case r is r and theta is d theta. So the arc length is going to be r d theta. And since we're taking the ratio of that value to the circumference, we also need the circumference. which is going to be pi d or 2 pi r. So it's around about now that we want to cancel out the r's and the pi's, which is going to leave us with r squared times d theta over 2, or r squared d theta over 2. So now the area of that little chunk of the pizza slice is equal to the area of the bigger pizza slice that uses this as its outer limit, minus the area of the littler pizza slice that uses that as its outer limit. So since the area of one pizza slice is r squared d theta over 2, the area of that little chunk is going to be d theta over 2 times r squared minus r minus dr squared, since this length right here is r minus dr. This is also equal to d theta over 2 times r squared minus r squared plus 2r dr minus dr squared. So the r squareds cancel out, leaving us with d theta over 2 times 2r dr minus dr squared. And we can pull out a dr, so we've got dr d theta over 2 times 2r minus dr. And since dr is approaching 0, we can take the limit as dr approaches 0 of that statement, which means that dr is going to approach negligibility, and we can ignore it, which means that we end up with dr d theta over 2 times 2r. And the 2's cancel out now, which leaves us with r dr d theta. And if we want the volume of that chunk, which we're going to be adding up, then we also need to multiply by dh. And if you remember, our integral looked something like that. The fact that this works can be demonstrated rather nicely with a graphing calculator. You can see here I've set up several graphs, and I'll walk you through them in just a second. This line of graphs here are the Jacobian of the given system, graphed in terms of x and z. And over here is the same Jacobian of the same system, graphed in its actual system. And over here are a couple demonstrations of the Jacobian value at work. So this graph here is the volume of a sphere with radius x. And the blue graph you can see there is the volume as found by integration, integration of the Jacobian. And the green graph is the volume as found by the formula. You can see over here I've got 4/3 pi times x cubed. And over here I've got a triple integral of this spherical Jacobian function that I set up over here, which is the Jacobian in spherical system, etc. So you can see that they're exactly the same. And over here is a similar thing, except with cylinders. So what I'm graphing here is the volume of a cylinder with radius x and height z. And again, the green one is as found by formula, and the blue one is as found by integration. And again, they're exactly the same. So you can see that this technique does work.